Good evening, everyone. Bethel is an inclusive faith community seeking to transform lives by exemplifying the unconditional love of Jesus. We extend a cordial and heartfelt welcome to all who join us in worship today in person, via Zoom, or live stream. Welcome to those new to the Christian faith, those who are longtime followers of Christ, as well as those who are just curious about faith in Christ. To our friends who are without a church home, and to those visiting with friends and family from another faith community, to those who need strength, want to follow Jesus Christ, have doubts, or do not yet believe, to people of every color, culture, sexual orientation, gender identification, economic background, age, size, ability, and challenges, old friends and new guests, to the old and the young, believers and questioners, and questioning believers, we welcome you to worship God with us on this day. I'd like to take a moment before I read the announcements to allow Louise to say a few words to all of us.
Hi, everyone. I'm here visiting Louisa, and she just wanted to say hi and thanks for the prayer. She's looking a whole lot better. Go ahead, Louise.
Oh, I'm so happy to be here, and I'm alive again. I was practically dead, I think. And thanks for all your prayers. I really appreciate them.
Okay.
See you soon.
Is it okay for me to send this out to the church members?
To everybody, yeah.
Okay, all right. Bye, everybody.
Bye, see you.
Louise, we love you so much, and it's been wonderful seeing your face. Carl, if you're out there in Zoom land today, thank you for bringing the cross. And now our announcements. We will be holding our annual congregational meeting on January 28th at 10 a.m. via Zoom. Please plan on attending this important meeting in the life of our church here at Bethel. And next, save the date, save the date, save the date. Bring your appetites and join us for our third Fun Friday on Friday, January 19th from 6:30 to 8:30 here in the chapel for an evening of family-friendly games and, of course, lots of pizza. Thank you.
Right. And may the peace of our Lord be with each and every one of you.
Also with you. Also.
Please join us in singing Trust in God.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. You've been the fourth man in the fire.
Say Jesus heard and he answered. I sought the Lord. Jesus heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. God, my Savior, the one
who will never fail.
God will never fail.
All things new. We've been doing a couple times, but trying to get this feeling of being closer to God. Yeah. Here we go. I've heard you can take what's broken and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do with them? I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let them fall, surrendered to the floor. You make
you make all things.
Today's scripture reading is from 2 Samuel 7, 1 through 6. After the king was settled in his palace and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am, living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." But that night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling." Here ends the reading.
Good evening. It's good to be back home. Well, I was wondering if you all would have me back. First of all, you had a bishop on the first Sunday I was gone, and I shared with you. Then you had this itinerant Baptist preacher the second Sunday. So both of them made it very hard to come back. And so thank you, Michael, and thank you, Papa Lawrence, for covering for me while I was away. I had a wonderful time in Jamaica. And so if my Jamaican accent slips out every now and then, it's because I've been around a bunch of Jamaicans saying, "Hey, man, what do you say?" So will you pray with me? Happy and blessed 2024 to all of you here and those who are worshiping with us in Zoom. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all that you are doing in our life and the plans that you have for us. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. It's been a long while, probably for as far back as high school or maybe my college days at Loyola University, since I read the poem "To a Mouse" by Robert Burns. Any of you have ever read that poem, "To a Mouse" by Robert Burns? Still, in preparation for this message, I looked at it again. And one takeaway or meaning of the poem is that no matter how carefully a project is planned, something will always go wrong with it. Another way of putting it would be to say that the best laid plans nevertheless go awry when putting them into practice. Unexpected difficulties arise, or the proverbial spanner or wrench, as they call it in Jamaica. In America, they would call it a hiccup that will be thrown into the plan, and sometimes causing the plan to go totally off chart. It could be something internal, it could be something external. And thus the saying, if you've heard this saying, the best made plans of what? Mouse and men. The poem's full title is, in fact, "To a Mouse on Turning Her Up in Her Nest with the Plow," November 1785. The full title of the poem really explains what the poem is all about, and it probably is really based on an actual event when Burns accidentally destroyed a mouse's nest while plowing in a field. The relevant stanza of the poem is toward the end, and here it is right here. "But Mousie, thou art not thy lane. Improving foresight may be vain, but best laid schemes, O mice and men, gang aft edgely, naught but grief and pain for promised joy." What the poem suggests is that mice and men often find that meddler that thwarts their plan, that meddler that's called fate. And the poem goes on, continuing to address the poor mouse he made homeless. "Still thou art blessed compared we me. The present only toucheth thee. O prospect dear and forward thou, I cannot see. I see and fear." And what the poet is saying is that humans, you and I, can remember the past schemes that also went awry. And because you and I have memory, we humans, we store up a lifetime of prospective drear and torts of hope. Not only that, but humans can fret. Humans can fear that the same thing that happened last time will happen again to whatever plans and whatever dreams we nurture or entertain the next time. So the poet concludes, of the best laid schemes of mice and men, those of men are worse. Like the poem, the scripture lesson that Lisa read for us today in 2 Samuel has some humor in it. You might have caught it. David is the newly appointed king of Israel. He has recently made Jerusalem the capital. The nation's enemies have been defeated, and the Ark of the Covenant is in the city. And David is comfortably settled in his new palace. Then David gets this idea. You can almost see the cartoon light bulb go off in his head when David said, I should build a house for God. What's funny to me is the response of the Almighty, which this is just a paraphrase, and it goes something like that. David, do you think that the creator of the universe, do you think that the sustainer of the universe needs some human-built rinky-dink house? So God says, I got this, I'm good. In essence, in these verses, David is instructed really to forget about building a house for God because God was in preparation to build a house for David. Silly as David's plan seemed. You and I can relate to this standard human intuition and probably recount instances where we have had this instinct. I want to do something grand. I want to make impressive plans. I want to leave my mark on this earth. I want to write the script for my future. And so here we are in January of a new year. And January is usually time when we do our planning, when we sit in front of our vision boards, our calendars, our spreadsheets, plugging in the plans and the projects and the programs, and we're envisioning everything that we will accomplish if everything works out. Because this is the year when all of the stars will align and things will fall in place and everything will come together. That's what I envision David doing. And that's what I envision going on in David's mind as he comes up with this grand plan to build God a house. But the Almighty's response to this eager, maybe even naive king got me thinking about plans. My plans. Your plans. If I was in a black church, they'd say, now you meddling talking about my plans, Pastor. You're not preaching anymore. You meddling. But even what scripture suggests to be the plans of God. In Jeremiah 29 and 11, one of my life verses, it says, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Okay, just humor me for a minute and turn to somebody next to you and smile at them. Show them all the teeth you have, whether God gave them to you or you bought them. And just say, God has plans for you. Tell them, God has plans for you. God has plans for you. And if that person didn't believe it, turn and talk to somebody else and tell them, God has plans for you. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. January, we usually make resolutions. We make plans for the upcoming year. So as we consider the plans that we have for this year, I want to invite you to consider
a few things that scripture suggests about God's plan. Now, I'm not suggesting that you don't have plans, because you either plan to fail when you fail to plan. So I'm not suggesting that you don't have plans. And even worse, I'm not even suggesting that you leave all the planning up to God. I'm not suggesting that even. All the planning up to God. Instead, in light of the scripture, what I'm suggesting is that scripture says that God's plans are complete. Scripture says that God's plans are specific. So what I want to invite you to consider today for the few minutes that I have in front of you is aligning your plans with what you understand God's plans to be for your life and for this year. Amen. Are God's plans almighty? Are God's plans complete and confident and possibly even better than our plans? For most of 2019, I was excited about the March 2020 trip I had planned, booked, and paid for to New Zealand. New Zealand is a destination I've always wanted to visit. Imagine the authentic tour of New Zealand, a journey that includes Auckland, a diverse city surrounded by dormant volcanoes and caves and lost treasures and wine tasting at the top of the world. And one tour guide describes it as a delicious banquet of mountain peaks, rainforests, rich farmlands, and electric towns where the mist of time meets the exuberant presence. But like many of you, I quickly realized that my plans weren't complete. You know why? I hadn't factored in a global pandemic. Probably because I can only prepare for what I can imagine, which suggests to me that my plans will always be incomplete. David imagined that the Almighty as a bigger version of who he was. And so God must need and want a place to stay. I can't stay in this palace all by myself and let the Ark of the Covenant stay out there. But I must be the one to build a house for God. And this is going to sound a little judgmental, so forgive me. But I often wonder about our modern day mega church pastors, if they've taken the approach of building a house for God with some of these gigantic sanctuaries and campuses on acres of land. When I lived in North Scottsdale, Arizona, there was a church there that had a bowling alley. They have all of the amenities of an all-inclusive resort. And I suppose if I would ask some of the mega church leaders, and some of them would probably say, Kenneth, you're just hating. But I'm not. they would say they built it for God. But knowing my ego, I would question whether it's for God or for me. God responds to David, your plans are incomplete. David said, I will, and I have. And notice what God does in the text. God replies with a couple of I haves and I wills of God's own. I have brought you out of the pasture. I have been with you. I have cut off your enemies. I will make you a great name. I will appoint a place for your people. I will plant them in their place. I have and I will. That's what God said to David. And while David planned a house for God, God was planning salvation for David. David's plans were limited. God's plan seemed to be complete. God's plan seemed to be comprehensive, leaving nothing out, including the salvation of the people. And that got me to thinking about the difference between how we plan and how scripture says that God plans. We plan calendars. God plans galaxies. We plan timelines. God plans lifetimes. We plan appointments. God plans seasons. We plan long-term strategies, but God plans from the Alpha to the Omega. We plan our to-do list, but God plans to overthrow evil, to overthrow death, to overthrow hatred and poverty and injustice and violence and human trafficking and homophobia. We plan, but not the way God plans. Have you ever felt that you need to remember something? You don't quite know what it is that you're forgetting, but you know that it's essential. And scripture suggests that God never forgets. God never overlooks. God never gets distracted. Another thing that scripture seems to suggest is that God's plans are never too small. God's plans are never too narrow or too self-interested. According to scripture, the Almighty plans are purposeful. The Almighty plans are powerful. The Almighty plans are whole and holy. How we plan and how God plans. The plans of the Almighty are complete because, according to scripture, with God, there is no such thing as an impossible plan. With God, there's no such thing as a maybe plan. With God, there's no such thing as an if we get lucky plan. But according to scripture, the word of the Almighty is an accomplishing word, which suggests to me that there is nothing in our life or the groaning of this world that is exempt from, outside of, or has escaped the redemptive power of God. Preach, Kenneth. I'm doing the best I can. Secondly, scripture suggests that God's plans are specific. God's plans are specific. I went to the bank to open an account before leaving for vacation. And no bankers were available. But the teller said to me, they said, Kenneth, you can make an appointment if you are willing to come back. And what did I do? I made an appointment so I would have the option. Even if I couldn't go back, I knew I had an appointment. And that's how you and I plan. Sometimes, because there is a good chance that something will happen to keep us from finishing what we started. Even something might happen to keep us from keeping that appointment. Sometimes we even hope the plans we made earlier will fall through. But notice what scripture says about God. God isn't like that. The Almighty plans are specific. In addition to everything God says to David in this passage, David is promised something that is absolutely amazing. David is promised something for his household, that his name would be established forever. David must have imagined after his little mishap with Bathsheba, David must have imagined that God had forgotten all about that promise. David's line seemed to end in occupation and exile, probably leaving David feeling that God had failed to keep God's promise. Have you ever felt like that? Have you ever felt like God did not keep that promise that God made to you? The thing we felt for sure would happen, crumbled. This was different. How could this happen? This wasn't the way my career was supposed to go. This wasn't the way my marriage was supposed to go. This wasn't the way my ministry was supposed to go. This wasn't the way my business was supposed to go. This wasn't the way this physical exam was supposed to go. Have you ever felt like God did not keep God's promise? We're acutely aware of these heartbreaks in our life. And I say that we often live between the gap of God's promise and the final fulfillment of God's promise. God said this, but I'm waiting right here for this to happen. And my aunt who asked me, what do I do right here when there's this and this? I said, that's the place of faith. That's the place of trustworthiness. In those difficult times when we can't even see it. You see, from one vantage point, it may have appeared that God's promise to build David a house and a legacy had fell through. God's promises were too good for David to grasp. And so David felt like the plan had been forfeited. But when you end the Old Testament in that book of Micah, and then you go to that first chapter of the New Testament in Matthew, we're confronted with something that reveals that God kept God's promises in the genealogy of Jesus. As Matthew opens his gospel, he starts by establishing that Jesus is the promised Messiah, the promised Davidic king. The promised one who would undo the curse of sin. So Matthew first outlines Jesus's genealogy. And if you trace Jesus's genealogy, there's some messed up folks. I'm for real. There's some messed up folks in Jesus's genealogy. So there's hope for you and me. There's some people you look and say, you need some help. I think you should see somebody in Jesus's genealogy. And Matthew arranges a selection of Jesus's ancestors into a list of three sets of 14 people. There are generations of 14 generations between Abraham and David. And several other 14 generations that go on. And in the middle of that, in the middle of Jesus's genealogy, David's in there. David's imagination was too small. Sometimes, like you and me, our imaginations are too small about the plans. I was talking to, and you know, I got three daughters, so you know, I'm into woman power, so. I was talking to a young lady once, and she was telling me about her plans to go to in the medical profession, and she said, you know, I want to be a nurse. I said, why don't you become a doctor? Why you got to stop there? Her dream was here. I said, why don't you just lift it up a little bit higher? David's imagination was too small. And sometimes ours are the same. When compared to God's plans, ours are tiny. Ours are timid. And we can admit that sometimes. We can confess that God's dreams sometimes are bigger than the dreams we have. Oh, God, if you just bless me with $100. God is saying, I wish you would have prayed for more because I was ready to bless you with some more. I just want a loaf. I just want a slice of bread. God said, I want to give you the whole loaf. I just want my foot in the door. God said, I'm seeing you as the CEO or CFO. My plans. God's plans. Sometimes we walk through life fixated on our agendas. Sometimes we walk through life fixated on our priorities and we're totally unaware that glory is just above our head. And sometimes the disarray of our plans distract us from the complete and specific promise that God wants to speak into our existence. Today, I'm closing with this. I want to invite you to have eyes like those shepherds in the Matthew account of the birth of Jesus. Eyes to look past the darkness and to see the light. Today, I want you to invite you to align your plans with God's plans. And if God's plans are up here, I got plans for you. Let's pray. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to give you a hope. Plans to give you a future. Help each of us gathered here today and those who are worshiping with us via Zoom to align our plans with your plans, to see the full potential of our possibility. Amen.
That's been my mantra this year, trying to align my will with God's will for me. That's really great words, Pastor, tonight. And now we're so grateful to have Ron join us again. Please join us in singing Jireh, who is enough for all of our plans. Thank you.
Jireh, as many of you might know, is one of the names of God in the Old Testament, and it means the Lord will provide. In Hebrew, Jireh, the Lord will provide. And so often in our life, we miss those many miracles. You know, we can go through life and not even pay attention to them. So I experienced one the other day in the Jireh context. I was at Whole Foods buying pizza for dinner, and when I got to the cash register, the internet had gone down. So all I had was my Apple Pay on my phone, and it couldn't read my phone. I fortunately had my wallet in my car because I just left the gym and I don't take my wallet into the gym, long story. But anyway, the guy said, do you have the actual credit card so you can swipe the credit card? I said, yeah, I'll run outside and get the credit card and then come back. By the time I came back, he had gone on to the next customer in the line behind me. And the guy looks at me and says, hey, dude, I mean, I'll pay for your pizza if you don't have a credit card. I said, I have a credit card, but thank you very much. And when he was ringing up his total for his grocery, he just told the cashier, I want to pay for his pizza. I mean, I had the resources, but it was just the Lord providing. So I had an opportunity then, and I have then to pay it forward with someone else today. And there's so many times when in our life God provides for us or gives us an opportunity to provide for others. So this is what our offering is about. It's not just about money, because yeah, money is necessary. Sometimes it's a necessary evil. But there are other ways that we give back our time, our talents, and our treasures. So I just want to say thank you for those of you who share your gifts, for blocking out this period of time to come and worship on Sunday evenings. And for the monetary gifts that you're able to give, we say thank you. So I offer a prayer right now. God, for all those many miracles that you perform in our life and those doors that sometimes we recognize when they're open, and sometimes they are so fast that they open and shut real fast and we don't even see them, but we suspect later on that your hand was involved. And thank you for the opportunity to give. And thank you for the opportunity to give back, to pay it forwards, pay it backwards, pay it sideways, whatever way you have blessed us. And you touch our hearts to be a blessing to others out of the blessings that we have. Amen. I would just want to say a brief prayer and then open it up. Thanks, Shane, for having the mic. I'm going to say a brief prayer, and then Shane will take the mic around and offer it to those of you here who would like to offer a prayer request or praise report. And then we'll open it up for our family on Zoom. Let's pray. Dear God, we have plans, and there is absolutely nothing wrong with planning. There's nothing wrong with using the intelligence that you have given us to look ahead and to anticipate things that we can do or ways that we can become better, ways that we can impact this world while we're here. There's nothing wrong with planning. But sometimes even in our planning is not enough. It's not big enough. It's not all encompassing. And so we offer to you today an opportunity to align our plans with your plan, to experience the greater plan for our life and greater purpose for our life. In the midst of the blessings that we experience here as individuals and as a family and as a community, we know that there are so many other people who are less fortunate than we are. Our trash cans can feed gourmet meals to some people on the streets. The clothes that we have in our closet that we haven't worn in 2 or 3 years would be an amazing outfit for someone on the streets. The roof that we live under, although we may complain about the size or the decoration or the location, or even the cost, there's someone who would love to have a roof over their head. And so in those moments when we are not fully appreciative of the blessings in our life, help us to remember those who are less fortunate. Help us to remember those who don't have the freedom that we have with all of the imperfections in America, with all of the injustice and the problems, political and social and injustice in America. There are a lot of people who would love to be here than where they are. We pray for those who are still being trafficked for their bodies and sold as cattle, like in the slavery days, women and men, young and old. We pray for those who are living with and receiving treatment for cancer. We thank you for the restorative work that you're doing in Luisa's body, and you're giving the medical professionals all that they need to help her live a happier, healthier life for however many years you have her on this earth. We pray for those who are in difficult relationships, either relationships that are ending or relationships where there is a lot of stress and turmoil. We pray for those who can't see, whose week is longer than their checkbook. We can't see how they're going to make it. Will I buy food or will I pay the light bill? We pray for those who are struggling with difficult decisions about life, where to go, what to do, how to answer the difficult questions that they're facing in terms of the next steps. Someone is at a crossroad and trying to make a decision. Help them to follow the path that will bring them the most joy and the most love and the most hope and the most peace. We pray for this nation and all the nations around the world. There is just so much going on, so much hatred, so much violence, so much murder, so much war, so much anger, politically, spiritually. We're such a polarized world, it seems, dear God. So we lift these things and so many other prayers to you, and we say, Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayers. Sanctuary, pure and holy, pure and holy, tried and true, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Sanctuary for you. Now sing it from your heart to God at this time. Lord, prepare me. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. To be a sanctuary, pure and holy. Pure and holy, tried and true. Tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Sanctuary for. At this table, we remember the love of Jesus for every single human being. The little children's song, red and yellow, black and white, they're all precious in his sight. Well, we could add gay and straight and trans, and everybody is precious in God's sight. So this is an open table. This is an open invitation to say, I love you, not just this much, but this much. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it. Then he gave it to his disciples. He said, take and eat. This is my body given for you, for you, for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people around the world. Do this in remembrance of me. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. This is the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. I invite those of you who are here who would like to receive communion to please come. Let's pray. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace now and forever. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of grace. And we pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift in faith towards you and love towards each other. May the blessings of God, creator, sustainer, and all life be with you all now and forever. God has planned for you. Amen.
Amen. Please join us in singing Halle Hallelujah.
Right, can y'all put your hands together
on,
like
everybody.
This? Yeah. Say Hallelujah.
Forsaken and forlorn.
you for joining us, and we will have some refreshments out here shortly.